Services. So today with me is Steve Messler. Steve is the co-founder and CEO of Classroom Champions. Now, I'm going to read this word for word, Steve, because I love the way that you've articulated it. For those of you that don't know what Classroom Champions is, it's a non-for-profit.
I can't take credit for how it's been articulated, so.
I'm going to say great job articulating it,
I'm sure.
Well, you're a non-for-profit. Yes. And what you do is you bring together children with the world's best to mentor and teach kids with the skills they need to succeed in and out of the classroom. So now, Steve, that is exactly what you've been doing for the past. When did you start Classroom Champions?
It's been about a decade since I was still competing in 2009, 2010, we started what turned into the pilot program.
Okay.
It's been about a decade.
So about a decade, but let's go back because you're an Olympian with gold medals under your belt. And more specifically for the 2010 bobsled at the Vancouver Olympic Games, which we can all remember back to that spot. And you were inspired through the values and lessons and experiences that you had to bring together that knowledge along with your other Olympians to bring that message to the classroom to infect and to really take it to the core of where we actually start building who we are as a person, which is kids in the classroom. So, Steve, tell me about that journey. What inspired you to switch gears? And I know this story because you and I talk, but I just want that story out there for everybody else. Yeah. Tell me about the journey to getting to the point where you're launching Classroom Champions.
Yes. Well, thank you for having me on. And I love telling this. I love telling this story because it involves my sister. My sister, who is my little sister, she's 3 years younger than me and is one of my best friends. And going into my final Olympic year, I'm here in Calgary at my house, in the basement of my house, as many of us are. I'm in the basement. My wife is two floors up and our child is taking over the main floor with grandma. So I was about three blocks away from here and I was on the phone with my sister going into the Vancouver Olympic season and just saying how I wanted to find a way for us, for her and I, to do something more than the classic school visits that I had always done. I'd always gone in, I'd given a talk, I'd leave, I'd never see those kids again. And we've all experienced that, whether we were children or our kids go through it, or if we're an educator, you have people come in. And that's the way the outside world has supported schools or supported kids for hundreds of years. We wanted to change that experience. We wanted to bring it into the 21st century. So we did something my last Olympic year that was literally only meant to be something that would just, you know, help us share what we would have thought was amazing when we were 10 years old and share my Olympic experience and show kids it wasn't just 2.5 weeks of glory on television, but there was a process. And sometimes it was great. Sometimes it was hard. Sometimes it was impossible. Sometimes you thought it was impossible. And all of a sudden that was my life. So we just wanted to share that journey. And that was the beginning of it, but it had never intended to be a nonprofit. It had never intended to be an organization. It was going to end with the Skypes that I did from the Olympic Villages in Whistler in Vancouver with eight, you know, different schools in America and one here in Calgary. And 10 years later, here we are. We've had over 200 Olympians and Paralympians and NFL players and NHL players and NCAA student athletes volunteer to serve millions of kids and teach them about just what it takes to be successful, not only in school, but in life. And we do that across a variety of different programs.
So, and I think that is such an amazing thing to talk about right now. I think we need to acknowledge the date. It's May 15th. And literally the world turned upside down like 9+ weeks ago with COVID. And it's really been a defining moment for a lot of people and a lot of in our lives, because it's affected every single person in the world. And so when we have the opportunity to go down a road, which we think we're going to go down, and we have this vision for what our life is, often something happens that turns it upside down. And then you pivot and you're onto a new track. So what was really the defining moment, if you can go back to that moment where you decided to make that pivot?
Well, I mean, I think it goes beyond that. It goes earlier than that, which is when, you know, how do you go? I was a track athlete at University of Florida, born and raised in Buffalo, track athlete, University of Florida. And next thing I knew, I was in the mountains of Europe, you know, in sledding with, you know, a bunch of guys wearing tights. And, you know, so I've done this before. So from a personal standpoint, you know, it seems to be every 10 years or so that there's this pivot that happens within my life. And, you know, early 2000s, when I made that change from track to bobsled, I had to just find the skills that I had as a track athlete, where I kept getting hurt, and just wasn't living the dreams I wanted. And long story short, found my way into bobsled, where I was able to use the strength and the speed that I had and the different tools that I had, and then go on to compete in 3 Olympic Games and win a gold medal. And in my career there, and then pivoting over as we were doing Classroom Champions, the way we started, I mean, Classroom Champions is a 21st century pen pals. We've been doing COVID proof mentoring for 10 years now. So when we see a lot of folks pivoting right now, Classroom Champions hasn't had to really pivot. They're pivoting our business model a little bit, but we haven't had to pivot the way we've been doing things from an impact standpoint. But when I made that second pivot in my life, and after the Olympics, where I never thought that I would be, you know, running international, you know, nonprofit charity. I thought that I didn't know what I was going to do when I left sport. But I knew I had certain tools, and I was a bit of a tech geek. So I knew how to edit. You know, I loved editing video. I loved doing those things. I loved talking to kids. I loved inspiring people. I loved taking the lessons that you learn through high level sport and converting that into life. I went into consulting for a little while here in Calgary, actually, and worked with various companies across the board, but really I found my love in growing Classroom Champions. And I made that other pivot a few years into that, you know, change from sport into what athletes would call the real world.
Amazing.
And really, it was really founded in just finding the skills, you know, identifying the skills that I had and looking what else I could do with them, whether it was track to bobsled or whether it was video editing to an inspiration into a Classroom Champions.
So what I find so remarkable about your story is the fact that you've never given up. You've had the challenges, you've had the roadblocks, but you're like, you've had that confidence that there's still more on my journey for me. So were you ever in a moment where you felt stuck, or were you always super on game?
No, I mean, I have moments where I feel stuck every day. I have moments where I feel stuck every year. I have moments where I feel stuck all the time. I think the sport analogy was always the easiest one. When you feel stuck, when you're losing consistently, that's more, you can see that. Like, winning and losing is easier to gain in sport. So it's a little less stressful, you know, in a lot of ways, because you know how much you're losing by. You know where you can look and see where you lost the time. When you get into life, you have to choose what winning and losing means. You have to choose whether winning and losing means more money. You have to choose whether winning and losing means more time with your kids. You have to, you know, choose whether winning and losing means just joy on a daily basis. Those people who are lucky enough to have all of those are unicorns, really. I mean, that doesn't happen that much. You have these trade-offs that happen. So, I think that's the thing that I've come to realize. Through the struggles I've had is that it's really hard to find that balance. So you kind of have to find ways to be hopeful and optimistic when you have, you know, 0-1 or 0-1-2 or all three of those things.
So what would you say some of those, I love the analogy how it's kind of like a unicorn, because you're like bang on. Whoever says that they have a perfect balanced life, I call a little BS on that one. I'm just saying, because.
Good for them. Good for you out there. I mean, that's the balance that you're looking, that's the balance we're looking for. Everybody has a different opinion of that, right? We may look and say, you have two, but like the amount of money you're making isn't that, but for that person, it might be. I think the older we get, the more comfortable we get with being flexible of what those things mean. The younger we are, the more we have the aspirations of what winning is, what that gold medal is. And as we get older, we realize, I never would have thought that being trapped in our house and stuck in my basement to work all day instead of being able to be downtown and, you know, Bow Valley Square and spending time in the plus 15s. I never really realized that getting to spend an extra 10 minutes every now and then with my 2.5-year-old would trump that 10 times over. So
amazing. And I think that that's probably, it comes with experience, being okay and comfortable in your own skin, to being a little bit more flexible. You're right on there. But I think what's really important too is that, you know, I interview so many women and we talk about the work-life balance or harmony or whatever that might be. And I just love the fact that it's, you know, it's a struggle for everybody. It's not men or it's everyone. So I think finding that passion, finding what you're really fired up about and prioritizing what's most important to you right in the moment is really key, which is, you know, right now for you spending time with your family.
Yeah. And, you know, we talk about absolutely. And that's where I love being on this show because I have a little girl and this entire thing has a whole different meaning now as a father of a daughter. And, but when it comes to, when it comes to work-life balance, it's funny. In sport, there was never that concept because your work was your life, your sleep, your eating, all the things you would consider life were the plugins to being successful at sport. Your stress and anxiety levels had to do with different you know, hormone levels in your body that you are always considering. So everything in your life you considered work, and you love that. And then when I left and I started hearing about this thing, work-life balance, and I started really trying to digest it and realizing that for us, and I try to talk about with our team at Classroom Champions and our, we have an amazing group of people. We are, we are probably, there's three guys and about, 15 or 16 women that work at Classroom Champions. So more of a place where I find that the women in our team are just do amazing things is we talk about more of like a stress thriving ratio rather than a work-life balance ratio. Mm-hmm. Where are you getting your stress? Where are you feeling like you're thriving? Because at the end of the day, you're getting stress from both work, but you're also getting stress from life and from whatever it is that's around. And more importantly, how are you finding your place, setting yourself up to thrive, whether that's at work or whether that's at personal, because it feels the same, like the hormones that happen, the feeling that you get, whether you had a successful project at work or whether you watched your kid ride their bike for the first time, the feeling, the endorphins you get are exactly the same. So we've started talking about it more at work of that stress thriving balance and how we find that in our lives and in our work, rather than thinking about it as a work life, because that winds up becoming a little bit narrow, where it doesn't mean that if you're working too much that you're not happy with life. And not necessarily. I love most of the work that I get to do. So.
And I can say I work a lot and I love it. Mm-hmm. People have to pull me away from work because I just enjoy it. I get those happy endorphins when I'm doing something that I'm passionate about doing. So I guess it's just the fit of what drives you and the purpose behind what drives you is really important.
Yeah.
So I do have to talk about the kids, that you've been changing the lives of the kids. You know, I look back at, you said, almost a decade of changing, really opening up the eyes of some really amazing kids and sharing the stories from truly remarkable and inspiring athletes that have walked the path. They could probably visualize them in their own shoes, you know, at 12 years old. Is it 12? Is that that age? Is that that tender age that you shoot for with your talks, or is it all over?
Our mentoring and curriculum programs focus on like kindergarten to grade 8. So okay. 5 or 6 up to 13.
Okay. Cause that's the time when they're, you know, I've got a 13-year-old and you're always waiting to see what the triggers are, what they're really important, what they're into, because they really form those, gosh, I'm going to go off and do the world. And that's what I'm going to do when I grow up, usually around that time. So I just love the fact that you've been talking to them about the experiences already. Cause somehow I'm actually thinking right now that with the pandemic, that now they can maybe go back and they've had some kind of experience or exposure to somebody that's overcome some sort of challenge and how to get through it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it just depends on, you know, the populations, and it depends on the areas that we work with. I mean, our mission, we focus on underserved communities. So whether that is in Northeast Calgary or Siksika First Nation, or whether that is up in Northeast BC, or Jane and Finch in Toronto, or Camden, New Jersey, rural Indiana, or, you know, East Los Angeles. We focus on, we have schools that have done are doing or have done Classroom Champions curriculum, which is a year long process, where it's either a curriculum that schools adopt that focuses on what's called in the education sphere, social and emotional learning, so SEL. Education, like all other industries, loves their acronyms. So SEL is the way that schools think about math, reading, science, social studies, and social emotional learning, which is the basis of, you know, how they interact with their peers, how they set goals, how they work as teams, the functions that, especially as this, you know, especially, and there's Brett right there. There's Brett right there staring down at me on the bouncy house right there.
Oh, so cute.
Right. You know, especially as we look at a world where these things hold so much information and knowledge, and you're looking at a workforce that is ever more increasing into social needs, whatever that is, whether it's customer service because the machines are doing so much else, or whether that is consulting or whatever those things are, where the next generation of workers are going to come into. What we know for a fact is we hire today people who get along with their peers, people who are reliable, people who are able to set a goal, break that goal down, and then build up towards it. And those are the things that schools have always had a hard time teaching. But those are also the places where sport, in its essence, lives. Those are the reasons we have our kids do sports. So what we've found is a way to take athletes and take mentorship, scale it, use technology to create relationships and or create curriculum for schools to be able to bring these values in, like goal setting, leadership, perseverance, feedback, emotions, and operationalize it so it fits into a school day. And that's the thing that is I'm so proud of. It has evolved so much from my sister and I just going, let's do something that is more impactful than going into a school, walking out and going, if one or two kids listened, it's worth my time, to now this massive team that we've literally seen millions of kids learn from Classroom Champions. We've mentored tens of thousands, and we've been able to do partnerships with, you know, from the Calgary Flames and Stamps and Roughnecks and Hitmen here in town, to the Buffalo Bills, to so many, you know, Olympians and Paralympians across the continent. That's the exciting part, is watching sport become real for kids who aren't athletes, who aren't self-selecting into these things. Mm-hmm. And to your point, putting somebody in their lives that is helping them see that if they set these goals and do these things and have the discipline to get there, they can reach it.
And, amazing.
Yeah.
So now I have to ask about this pivot, or this not, you know, you've been working for a decade on redefining, tweaking, growing, learning as you, and it looks like you've really, and I know that we've had conversations before, and we could talk forever about it because you've definitely so passionate about it, and you keep on finding holes to fill and opportunities. So what are some of the opportunities that you and your team have found with COVID?
With COVID. Great. I mean, it's a great question. And you've got to be able to realize and recognize when you're a business owner, whether you're running a nonprofit or whether you're in a for-profit, of what are your strengths, what's the need, what's the challenge, and then how can you fill those things? So some big opportunities we've seen are, there's a lot of sports teams who maybe have done camps or have done things in person. They've relied on that to be their community outreach. And they've supported organizations that have done that, or they've done that themselves. Well, all of that is obviously not possible right now. Well, Classroom Champions has taken sport and athletes for a decade and implemented them into ways that actually create measurable change in kids. So we're working with a lot of different sports, professional sports organizations that are just thinking about, how do you do this? And they don't know. And so we've been advising a lot of organizations. We've started to partner with a handful of others. And I'm really proud of what we've done with Candace and her team over at the Flames to create the Calgary Sports Entertainment Corporation site that you can get to through United by Calgary on the Flames site. And it's things like that. So it's opportunities like that. It's opportunities from corporate standpoints that they're seeing. Again, they're having to think about, how do they shift their community investment? How do they shift their marketing? How do they shift that in a way that is digital, virtual, you can reach kids and actually will make a difference? Because today, if anything, I mean, I would say to everybody out there, is make sure whatever you're doing, if you are communicating that you're communicating useful information, because there's so much noise right now. And then if you're activating, make sure that those activations are something that you can measure and see what the changes can be made, because people are going to get judged by if they took advantage of this opportunity that was right now in a negative way or in a self-serving way, or if they took advantage of this opportunity in a society serving way. So we're trying to keep that in mind all the time right now.
And you and I are so aligned with a lot of that stuff, like everything that you're talking about. I'm like, yes, yes, yes. Right. Because it's all about building relationships.
Yeah.
And helping and serving. And I really think that your role modeling, you're leading by example. And I love that, you know, you've got this little girl that you're bringing up and you're paving the way for, you know, her to be a strong, independent woman. But you're also saying, you know, I'm a man that supports women. I mean, we've had many conversations about that. And so talk to me about your passion for, you know, really being an ally and a champion for women.
Oh, I mean, it starts with right there. I mean, that was lunch today in her ladybug outfit.
So for those of you that are watching right now, yeah, the iPhone with the little ladybug outfit, and
He's 2.5. Yeah. Yeah. Thereabouts. Yeah.
And your grin is like from ear to ear. Because once we take this off the video and we do a podcast only, they'll be like, I want to visualize that happy glowing face.
Happy and
that
little blonde curl poking out from underneath her ladybug hood for her outfit that she is happily wearing as we're potty training this week. And she is 3 days for 3 days, because she understands if she goes in her underwear, well, she's wearing the ladybug outfit, she can't wear the ladybug outfit anymore. So we've hacked the system, because she had a couple bad days before that. Like for us, it's always been, whether it is Olympians or Paralympians, looking at all ships rise. So how do you take certain people, certain areas or people or brands that are strong, and then how do you help use those brands to lift up others? And whether it is an Olympian lifting up kids, whether it is a pro athlete helping lift up Olympians and Paralympians so that kids see them more, or whether it is taking Haley Wickenheiser in our first year in Canada, when we expanded from the US up into Canada, when Haley was one of our mentors going into the 2014 Sochi Olympics, and she was matched with a school in Northeast Calgary. And the really, really impressive thing we saw was the principal had said to me halfway through the year is they had a lot of kids who were from the Middle East, and there's a culture, more of an oppressive culture for women in the Middle East. And what she noticed was with Haley Wickenheiser as their mentor, the little boys in the class were treating the little girls differently, because they had never been put in a position where the woman was the one that was looked up to in the room, in the society, in the culture, in the way that Haley was on an ongoing, regular, monthly basis, as Haley sent things to them from around the world and taught them different skills. And all of a sudden they started noticing how boys treated girls. So I think that was one thing that really brought to light the power of what we were doing. And you know, another part of that is how we curate the topics that we're putting in front of the kids. Mm-hmm. So feedback is a topic that we put into play last year. And you know, when you think about it, if you had a classroom, or as a parent, if you had a 10-year-old or a 12-year-old or a 13-year-old that would respond to your feedback in a way an Olympic athlete responds to their coach, where they do something, then they look at the coach and they say, what did I do wrong? Tell me. And then tell me how to do it right. Imagine if that's the way our kids acted.
Oh my God.
Right. Like, I mean, everybody can stop and the fireworks can go off and we could, you know, we can sit and have our coffee or have our martini and we're good. But when we think about the topics that we put in front of, and we turn into curricular, deep curricular units for schools to put into place, feedback and the impact that early feedback has on little girls was a big piece of where that subject came from, where the research out there will show that we give feedback to even a 5-year-old or even a 3-year-old, a little girl, different than a little boy. A little girl, we will try to, we'll try to say that it's okay. We will give them more breaks. A little boy will be more direct. We'll yell at them. We will, and that I say we from a general stance and what the research says. And what that turns into is, it turns into the stereotypes that we see later in life. It turns into, you know, the guys will just fight and knock it out and then they'll be good. And it's because that feedback starts so young. So if we can shape the way that teachers and families and kids are thinking about the way they give each other feedback and doing it more in a gender neutral way, then it's going to set those girls up for success. And this is coming from somebody whose daughter is named Brett, because we wanted to put her in a position where her gender was going to be, was going to be something that wasn't noticed in an email, or to me, you know, up on a scoreboard with Brett Messler, you know, dominating the competition. So we think of it at Classroom Champions, and I think of it at Classroom Champions in what the research is telling us, what the experiences that we're seeing in the classroom are, and then how we can have an all ships rise approach.
Amazing. Now, I also remember a conversation that your partner in life, your wife, is very
smart. Smart is the word.
Very smart. And this is actually an area of her expertise as well.
Mm-hmm. So maybe the feedback story,
a little bit about that, because I was in awe to learn. And I still, by the way, need to be connected to your wife.
Yes, I think that's my fault. Yeah. in the conversation, the story I just told about the feedback subject, she tells much more eloquently, because it came from a conversation. We were on our way to a Soyuz a couple years ago, and driving from Penticton down with, you know, when Brett was still, you know, still an infant, and we were having this conversation, and she was talking about the research, and we started talking about it. It came from a work discussion that turned into that, and she started talking about the research, and I started talking about that's what athletes are great at. Like, we're always trying to find, like, what are athletes wonderful at? What does the research say? And then how can we take that athlete message and then turn it into curriculum? So the athletes become the hook to get the kids and get the parents and get the teachers excited about talking about that. And then the weighted, the PhDs and the educators put the curriculum together underneath it. So instead of just starting from a research-based thing, we kind of put those two things together from a sport and a research-based area. And because at the end of the day, we're looking for outcomes. We're looking to help schools improve grades, improve attendance, decrease behavioral issues, decrease suspensions, because if kids aren't in school, they can't learn. And then give these kids a better way to learn the tools that we need to hire 10, 15 years later.
So, very important question, because I think there's probably a lot of people listening that are on the edge of their seat, just like I am, going, tell me more. So, how can people get involved? Say they have a school, they're a principal, mm-hmm. they're an educator, people that want to help support you. So maybe just lay it all out, where they can go to get the information to learn more about Classroom Champions, yep. to become involved, maybe to have that program included into their curriculum, because they would love to have that for their school if they don't have already. And just knowledge.
Yeah. First, if you're on the edge of your seat, I would say sit back, relax. You gave the date already, so we can give it away. It's a Friday afternoon as we're having this conversation. So everybody just, classroomchampions.org. Is the simplest way to go. Anybody can also email me at smessler, M-E-S-L-E-R, at classroomchampions.org, and I will gladly put you in touch with whoever you need to. We are lining up our mentorship programs for next year, especially as schools are trying to figure out whether are we going to be in school? Are we going to start in school and then move virtual? Are we going to start virtual? The beauty about having mentorship that is online is that it doesn't matter. This week there were dozens of live chats that happened between the athlete mentors and their assigned classrooms as the kids sat at home. So classroomchampions.org, by far the easiest place to go.
And I love the flexibility out of the online piece, because it really does open up the door even for the people that are able to help and support you as far as the Olympians, because they could be anywhere in the world.
It's really revolutionized the way that athletes, we're working with not the has-beens like me, not the ones who are telling kids about my story, but we want kids to learn with the people as they are on their journeys. And you couldn't do that 15 years ago. You could barely do it 10 years ago. And now we've been able to make it, do it in a way that works for the athletes, works for schools. And it's really changed the way that sport is looking at the way they can give back. And I'm really proud of that accomplishment from our organization standpoint.
Well, it has been such a treat speaking to you, Steve. I was really excited that we could actually find time. And then we're actually booking it right at the end of a Friday on a long weekend. So thank you. Thank you to your family for allowing you that opportunity to talk to us. I'm looking forward to having many more conversations with you, of course, because there's lots of synergies between what we're doing for you know, Universal Women's Network and our Woman of Inspiration, our leaders that are business leaders and female entrepreneurs, that there is a whole great big world that we need to tap into that area for young women.
Keep it up, because my daughter's watching. My daughter's watching. Keep it up, everybody out there. You know, get after it. We are, you know, whether it's folks like me who are behind it, or whether it's folks like you, Monica, who are leading it, I would just say that keep driving with it. Find, you know, through COVID, it's hard. It really, really is. You know, being in isolation is hard. For those of us that are extroverts like Monica and I, it's really hard. For those that aren't, you know, enjoy that peacefulness. Enjoy not having to, you know, have the Monicas and Steves around you. But, you know, I mean, I would say that right now we need to keep up this kind of work, and history is going to judge us X amount of years from now for how we handle this right now. I mean, this is something that we've never seen. Hopefully we won't have to see in our lifetimes again. Hopefully our kids won't have to see it, but history is going to judge us for the way that we treat each other right now. And, you know, being in the American that's lived in Canada for 17 years, that's extremely important to me right now too.
Amazing. Well, I just want to say thank you again, Steve. It was a pleasure being able to interview you today, and I look forward to sharing the link so that you can share it in your network. So people that aren't up to speed on that rapid speed of all those great things that you're doing could sit back and digest it and share it with their friends and family and others in the community, anywhere in the world, really. So thank you, Steve. Have a wonderful long weekend. Again, this is the Woman of Inspiration podcast, and this was a fabulous interview with Support Her, Steve, who's the co-founder of Classroom Champions. So thank you so much, Steve. Have a wonderful, wonderful long weekend with your family, and we will get through this. We will.
Thanks, you too. Take care.
Bye.
Thanks for having me. Bye.